بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، فإن خير الكلام كلام الله، وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة. وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أعاذنا الله تعالى جميعا من نار جهنم ومن عذابها. Before beginning, inshallah, Azza wa Jal, just want to share with you brothers an authentic hadith about the etiquette of the masjid. Any masjid, every masjid, is from the nur that the Prophet brought, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, and it's connected to the topic of today's discussion as well. Abu Tha'lab, or Abu Tha'lab al-Khushani, may Allah be pleased with him, he said that he was on a trip with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions when they were traveling. And then they became tired. And because the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sent as a rahmah to everyone, especially to the people who were with him and around him, from his companions, from his atba', those people from his ummah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he used to always have rahmah upon them. As for him, he was extremely strong, and he can deal with and tolerate and have the tahammul that 30, 40, 50 people didn't have. But looking at their situation, seeing that they traveled a long distance, he took a break from the trip. He went into a tent that was for him, and he looked outside of the tent, and he saw that his companions, radiallahu anhum ajma'in, some of the people, they went over there, and some of the people went over there, and some of the people went over there. So he called them together and he said to them, Mali arakum ma'izin. إن تفرقكم في هذه الشعار والأودية إن ذلك من الشيطان. He said, what is it that I see that you people are all divided and split up amongst yourselves? He said, this division of yours is from the shaytan. And the division that they had at that moment on that day wasn't a division of different opinions, اختلاف in the آراء. It wasn't a division as a result of al-asabiyya. This one is Arab, that's not Arab. This one is rich, that's not, it wasn't from that. It was just a mundane issue. He just wanted to rest over there and he wanted to rest over there. It's mundane. But when the Prophet saw that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he stopped them from doing that and he said, this is from the shaytan. The rawi of the hadith, he said, after that, whenever we were with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam and we came together for an issue, we were coming close to him when he was talking to the point of somewhere to throw down or to stretch out a blanket, the blanket wouldn't hit the floor. This hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has a lot of benefits in it, and it's very difficult to be practiced by the Muslims of today. Although the hadith is simple, really, but the benefits of it. We have these new apparatuses, the technology of today, like the microphone, the mukabbir al-sawt. Someone can come and he can scream at the top of his voice. Al-khilafa, al-khilafa, al-islam, al-islam, al-jihad, al-jihad. When people make screaming like that, empty slogans, important slogans, but they're empty because there are some practical things that he showed us that we should do on a daily basis, that we don't do. Things that are right in front of our noses, and they're easy to do. Like the Taswiyat al-Sufuf. When the Prophet was going to pray, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told his companions, As-salatu khayru mawdu'. فَمِنَ اسْتَطَعَ أَنْ يَسْتَكْثِرْ مِنْهَا فَلْيَسْتَكْثِرْ. The prayer is the best thing that you can do in the course of a day. From the time that that sun came up this morning at Fajr time until now, Maghrib time, there were many things to do, many things. But you didn't do anything better in terms of your actions. You didn't do anything better than praying. It's the best thing that you can do. Bani Adam. So everything connected to it is important. So when he used to pray in the Jama'ah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he wouldn't do what many of the masajid do, what we do. The imam just faced the qibla and says, Allahu Akbar, and starts praying. He wouldn't do that. He wanted to make the tahqiq of some of the ahdaf of al-Islam. So what would he do? He would send Umar radiallahu anhu down that line, and he would send Bilal ibn Rabah radiallahu anhuma wa ardahuma down that line. And they would go down the line making sure that the row was straight. And Bilal ibn Rabah, who was a mullah, he was Habish. He used to touch people who were from Quraysh. People like Abu Sufyan, Abdurrahman ibn Auf, Abu Bakr, Uthman, Ali. And the Quraysh, the Arabs of Quraysh, are the best human beings in terms of their lineage, in terms of their nasab. They're the best human beings. And Bilal ibn Rabah, he was a mullah from Ethiopia. He used to grab some of them and pull them, and he used to push them back to make sure that the road was straight. So the Prophet used to say a lot of things before he prayed, and this is the shahid. One of the things that he would say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was, إِنَّ تَصْوِيتُ الصُّفُوفِ لَتَصُوُنَّ صُفُوفَكُمْ أَوْ يُخَالِفَنَّ اللَّهُ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ. If you people don't straighten out your lines, Allah is going to cause ikhtilaf to be between your hearts. That's a practical thing that he used to do every day to teach the people how to be united. Al-Islam, al-Islam, al-Jihad, al-Jihad, al-Ittihad, al-Ittihad. We can do that. Scream, scream, scream. But the Prophet used to do things on a daily basis, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that developed love between the Muslims, tolerance between the Muslims, and unity between the Muslims. This is not my subject matter, but it's an important issue. The Muslims want to be united, then let them pay attention to the aqidah that the Prophet brought, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As I said before you, Wallahi thumma billahi thumma tallahi. If there was a human being who cursed my mother, who gave birth to me, may Allah guide her to Islam, guide her to Tawheed, her and my father. If a person cursed my mother, my father, from the fitrah, I don't have to be taught this, from the fitrah, I'm going to defend my mother's honor. I'm going to defend her. If someone drew a picture of my mother, I really be lying, he drew a picture of my mother, and he drew her in a way that was not nice, drew her in a way that there's istihza about her mahasin, wa'udhu billah. The fitrah is going to push me to deal with that person. So what is the case with the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It's even more so. So the point is, if there's a person from Bani Adam, even if he claims that he's a Muslim, if he's cursing the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that person believes that our mother Aisha, as Allah mentioned in the Quran, النَّبِيُّ أَوْلَى بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ وَأَزْوَاجُ أُمَّهَاتُهُمْ. If a person were to curse Aisha radiallahu anha, and he said that she was a zaniya, I'm not going to be united with him ever. Never. It's like him saying, my mother who gave me birth, he said that about my mother. He has ignited a bomb to have a fight with me. I'll never be united with him. I'm going to have a problem. And that's the fitrah. And I know that Aisha, for an example, she's in the Jannat al-Firdaus with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No doubt about it. She's close to the Maqam al-Mahmood. No doubt about it. He says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أنا وكافر اليتيم كهاتيني في الجنة. And he put his fingers like that. I will be like this close to the one who takes care of an orphan. He put his fingers like that. He didn't do like that because no one's going to be like this with him. He's going to have the maqam al-mahmud and mahmud by himself, But people will be close to him. And no doubt, when they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved person to you? He said, Aisha. They said, no, we don't mean from the women. We know your wife is going to be the most beloved. They said, from the men. He said, then her father, Abu Bakr. So if those people were the most closest to him and the ones he loved, clearly they're going to be close to him in Jannah. So the point here, Ikhwani, is that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, he used to teach us how to be united in practical ways. He told us, after al-ta'am, the best food that you can eat is the food that has a lot of hands in the plate. So his sunnah was, he never used to eat by himself. He used to bring the plate out, and his family members would eat together. He'd bring the plate out, and multiple people would eat around that plate. And he told the people to eat from the plate from the outside and go towards the middle, and the barakah was in the middle. And he also told the people that after you finish eating, you should lick your fingers off because the barakah was on your fingers as well, on your hands. So what does that do? If I'm eating the plate with him and him and him and him, I'm going to develop love for him, tolerance for him, brotherhood for him. I can get up here and say, Al-Akhuwa, Al-Akhuwa, Al-Akhuwa. But, which means brotherhood, brotherhood, brotherhood. But when it comes to some of the basic issues in the religion, like, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. We don't have that. And I'm talking about al-akhuwa, al-akhuwa. None of you truly believes who he loves to his brother what he loves to himself. So he taught us practical things on a daily basis. So the shahid of that kalam is, before we started, I saw some people back there, alhamdulillah, but as we started going on, people started moving up, so they understood what I was going to say. So I just want to spread this sunnah and this knowledge amongst you. It goes beyond the etiquette of sitting in the masjid. The sunnah that I want to spread to you is, the masjid has a special role in the life of the Muslims, just not four walls. The masjid of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was less expensive than this masjid right here. But the Nur of al-Islam spread to the four corners of the earth because the men who were with him, radiallahu anhum, they practiced this religion a particular way. And the way that they practiced the religion is the only religion and the only deen that Allah is going to accept, yawm al-qiyamah. So it's a responsibility of all of us, our responsibility to come to understand. How did they practice this religion? So as a reaver, your brother, in some cases I'm older than some of you, in some cases I'm younger than some of you, in some cases we are the same age as your brother who's a reaver, I say to you, it is not for us just to say, I'm a Muslim, I believe in the Quran and the Sunnah. But we all have to go a step further and say, we are Muslims who believe in the Quran and the Sunnah, inshallah, and we understand that Quran and the Sunnah the way Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Rukasha, Bilal, Zayd ibn Thabit, radiallahu anhum, the way they understood that book and the way they understood that sunnah. So for my reverb brothers out there, and I say this to you specially, there's a lot of rewards being a reverb, a lot of rewards, especially if you come from the Ahlul Kitab. If you were a Christian or a Jew before Islam, there's rewards for that, special rewards for that. But what I want to tell you is, when we look around in our masjid right now, we see a sea of different ethnic groups, different colors, and that's from the beauty of al-Islam. In Christianity, there's institutionalized racism. And the most important thing in their religion is racism. When you say that Isa is the son of Allah, that's racism. Especially when we see that Isa has been projected. He has been given the picture of being a white man with blue eyes and blonde hair, telling people worship that. That's racism. Although different colored people are Christians, it's a racist religion. Isa ibn Maryam, his ethnic background was he was a Hebrew. So Elijah Jalal, according to them, made a Hebrew man the Ilah, or the Ibn of the Ilah. That's racism. Judaism is a religion of racism. It's a religion of racism. And that the Yahud believe that they are the Sha'bullah al-Mukhtar. That's why they feel they can do anything to anybody. They can come and take people's land. They can just do anything, kill people. And their conscience allows them to do that. Sikhism, Hinduism, all those other religions, they have racism in it. Al-Islam, we have people who are racist. We have Muslims who are racist. But the religion of Al-Islam is not racist. As a matter of fact, the deen dealt with racism. So, for you revert brothers especially, when we look at our different brothers who come from different parts of the world, we say it's a beautiful thing. But now that you have embraced the religion, you make sure that you make it your business to learn this religion. And every single thing that you believe in, every single thing that you do from the ibadah, from the worship of Al-Islam, you have to make sure you can look back at the Quran and you can look back at the Sunnah. And those two things, what you're doing, what you're believing, what you're saying, you can find them in the Quran and the Sunnah. But even more important than that, or just as important, you found them in the Quran and the Sunnah in Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Ukasha, Bilal, Zayd ibn Thabit. They were doing the same thing. They were understanding the ayah the same way, the hadith the same way. If you do that, you'll be okay. Inshallah. So that Sunnah is, when we come to the Masjid Ikhwani, try to come together, it's one of those practical issues that will cause our community, inshallah, to develop tolerance for each other and to also have the tabiq of the brotherhood that the Prophet brought, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ إِخْوَةٌ. Concerning the issue of ad-dawah and the importance of ad-dawah, this is a really critical issue, especially during this time where we have legislation being put into effect where people are trying to change the complexion of Al-Islam. The Muslim 15, 20, 30 years from now in the UK, Allahu A'lam, what is he going to look like? Especially when we have Muslim experts, nas'al Allah al-afiyah wa salama, Muslim experts giving their expert opinions, and their expert opinions have nothing to do with what Allah sent down in his book or the Prophet brought in the Sunnah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. The dawah of Al-Islam has become something weird today. How we give dawah, how we understand dawah. So with that, we want to say that this is a very massive and expansive issue, but we want to deal with some of the jawanib of the issue according to the short time that we have, inshallah. First thing we want to mention and bring to your attention is, in this community, in this masjid right now, ad-da'wah Allah is wajib, is fard kifayah on everybody here. It is an obligation upon everybody here as an individual to give da'wah Allah, as a family to give da'wah. Da'wah to your neighbors, da'wah to your co-workers, da'wah to those people who you work with, who you live around, who you go to school with. This country, we have a responsibility to make and to give a da'wah to Allah. This masjid being right here in this place, and these people on this street, Yawmul Qiyamah, we're going to be asked about this situation. A da'wah to Allah is wajib. It doesn't mean that you have to give the khutbah to Jummah. It doesn't mean that you have to memorize Sahih Bukhari. It doesn't mean that you have to give a lecture or you have to do the Eid khutbah. But it means that you learn enough about your religion that you're able to give da'wah to your children. The mother and the father have to give da'wah to their children. The children have to give da'wah to each other. The children have to give da'wah to their mother and father. You have to give da'wah to your relatives. In this masjid right now, there's a lot of da'wah to be given to one another. How do we know that a da'wah is wajib? Because Allah Ta'ala mentioned that in the Quran, in many ayat, in the Prophet as well, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. From that, it's the statement of Allah in the command, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ. Let there be a group of people from amongst you who give da'wah to the good. And in this ayat, linguistically, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ, that's the lam al-amr. It is an obligation on everybody to give da'wah. He has to give da'wah according to his ability. His ability may be a little, or his ability may be a lot. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in an authentic hadith to all of the Muslims, بَلِّغُ أَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةٌ. Tell the people about me, even if it's one ayah, something small, something that people wouldn't deem as being very big or insignificant, but tell the people that which you know. So a da'wah to Allah is an obligation. Everybody has to do it. But he has to do it according to his ability. As for the one who thinks that as a Muslim he can exist and he has no role to play, this person doesn't exist in al-Islam. That's the action of the munafiqeen. The munafiq is the one who believes it's okay for him to sit on the sidelines and he has nothing to do. No, everybody has something to do in this deen. Everybody has some responsibility. Multiple responsibilities. And one of the most important responsibilities is a dawah. And I give you an example. When you know in our religion we are allowed to marry women who are from Ahlul Kitab. And this is the case with some people. The man, he marries a woman from Ahlul Kitab. She was a Jew, or she is a Jew, she is a Christian. And she is a woman who is afifa. Then you can marry her. In being married to that lady, we have to give him dawah to Allah. We have to give dawah to Allah. And the best kind of dawah is the dawah of the actions. As I mentioned, a person can scream all day, al-Islam, 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 Islam. But if she is not seeing that being a reflection in this behavior, then what's the benefit of that? And that's why the Prophet and the Messenger used to say in the Quran, وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أُخَالِفَكُمْ إِلَى مَا أَنْهَاكُمْ. And I don't want to go against what I'm telling you to do. I'm telling you to do this and I do the other thing. So people like that, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, not one person throughout his whole life of being a Nabi, a Rasul, 23 years, not one person was able to come and they were able to say he did something that they could be upset with him about. Whereas today, people can look at most of us, illa man asamahullah. People can look at us and say, this is a bad thing, a bad reflection. And all you have to do is look at the people who are claiming Islam today in the world. All you have to do is look at the people who are claiming jihad in the world today. And now Muslims will say, if you Muslims are really on the truth, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was really this person who you say he was, then why do we see this from you? So a doubt Allah, ikhwani, no doubt, the lisan is important. Because the man came and said, Ya Rasulullah, tell me something that I only can ask you of. Only you. He said, Qul, amantu billahi thumma istaqim. Say, I believe in Allah, and then be upright. So you have to say it. You have to tell your mother, you have to tell your wife, I love you. You have to tell your children, I love you. That's important. But the af'al, they are abla min al-aqwal. We have to show that even more. Actions speak louder than words. So the ruling of a da'wah is wajib. The person who doesn't do it, he is muqassir, or he is muhmin, and he doesn't do the da'wah. As a result of that, he is putting himself in an awkward position, a dangerous position with Allah Azza wa Jalla. Second issue that we want to mention right now, ikhwani, is the da'wah that we are obligated to give. What is it towards? What is it to? And this is really important. What is the da'wah to and what is it towards? The da'wah that we give, the da'wah that's obligatory upon us as Muslims, responsibility is, the da'wah should be to Allah. The da'wah shouldn't be to your sheikh. It shouldn't be to your madhhab. It shouldn't be to your qabila. It shouldn't be to your masjid. It shouldn't be to yourself. The person gives da'wah and someone doesn't accept what he's saying and he gets upset with that individual. The person who's giving da'wah, he gives da'wah in a rough and tough and nasty way. The person who's giving da'wah, and the da'wah that he's giving, he thinks it is islah. But in reality, it is a problem. It's fitna and fasad. So Allah Ta'ala mentioned many ayat of the Quran as well as the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. He said, this is my way. Tell them, this is my way. I call to Allah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was on such a high level of akhlaq, it was easy for him to call people to himself, but he never did that. One time, some of the companions, they wanted him. So they went to one of his hujarat, where he was living in his inner compartment. He started calling them. They were calling him from inside. They said, Ya Sayyidina Wabna Sayyidina, Ya Khairana Wabna Khairina, Oh our master, the son of our master, Oh the best from us, and the son of the best from us. They wanted him to come outside. When he heard them making that mubalagha and that ghulu, it was true what they were saying, that he was the Sayyid, no doubt about it, and he's the Khair of the people. He came out and he told the people, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, لَا يَسْتَجِيَنَّكُمُ الشَّيْطَانِ Don't let shaitan trick you people. قُلُوا عَبْدُلَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ Just call me Abdullah Rasulullah. Don't do that. The point is, he didn't take advantage of the people. The Bedouin would come from the Badr, from the desert, come to the masjid to visit or to meet the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, to embrace Islam. He would come to the masjid, he would come in, and he has to say to the people, where is Muhammad? Where is Muhammad? They would say, you see the one over there in the corner laying down? That's him over there. Because he blended in. He didn't sit on some high chair with an umbrella over him and two people were standing there with swords. You know who he is. He was just lying over there. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the point here is, if anyone deserved to call to himself, it was him. But he was against that. He never allowed that to happen. Today, the man has the ring, the sheikh, for example, the leader. In order to get close to him, you have to kiss that ring. You have to kiss his hand. And if you don't stand up for him and kiss his hand, or you don't, if you sit down before him, it's going to be a problem. So the da'wah is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلٍ مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ Who is better in his speech than the one who calls to Allah? Now, as a revert brother, as a revert person, when I came into the religion, I found the Muslims telling me, you have to do this. Why do I have to do that? Because the sheikh said, that imam said, the madhab says, this and that. And that's not to put the imams and the ulama of al-Islam down. No. But the imams of al-Islam, the ulama of al-Islam, if I can give this example, they are like the lights on the ceiling. They're like the lights on the ceiling. Right now, at this time after Maghrib, the sun went down. If we cut off or we turn off the lights in this masjid, we won't be able to read the notes. We won't be able to read the Quran. We won't be able to read the ahadith. It goes dark. When we turn on the lights help us to read the Quran, help us to read the ahadith. The goal and the objective is the Quran and the Sunnah, the Quran and the Hadith. The goal and the objective is not the light, because that light over there is flickering and it needs to be changed. And that light over there, it died out, it's finished. And this light over there has another problem. That light over here is brighter than that. The lights are not the goal and the objective. The goal and the objective is the Quran and the Sunnah. People have made the goal and the objective what the sheikh said, what the madhab said. So the sheikh is good, the madhab is good, but that's not the goal and the objective. So I want to ask you brothers a question. Who is the only person, Ya Ummat al-Islam, who is the only human being, who is the only one who is ma'soom? He doesn't make any mistakes when it comes to relaying this message. Who is that individual? You guys said it very low. I don't know if you have shakk or something like that. Who is the only human being who is ma'soom and we have to listen to him only, unconditionally. Who is he? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now we all say that and we believe that, but when it comes to the land of application, this is the challenge. This is the challenge. Because unfortunately some of us, the way we are, we hate our Muslim brothers simply because his madhab is not our madhab, his jama'at is not our jama'at, my sheikh is different from his sheikh. And that's not permissible, and that's not what the Prophet was upon, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. He, sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam, sent his companions out to give da'wah, like Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He sent Mu'adh, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Musa al-Ash'ari, Abu Dajjana. He sent them to Al-Yemen at different times. He was preparing Mu'adh ibn Jabal to go to al-Yemen. And the Yemenis were the only people from the Arabs who embraced Islam without fighting back. And that was from the tawfiq of Allah Azza wa Jal, and the people were sent to them. Yawm al-Qiyamah, this person, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, is going to be raised up, and he's going to be holding a flag. And behind him will be all of the ulama. The Prophet told the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, istaqru al-Qur'an min arba. He told his companions, learn the Qur'an from four people. One of them, Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He was from the ulama of the companions. He wasn't jahil. He wasn't some companion who had just came out of the badia. The Bedouin who came out of the badia, came to the masjid, he pulled his pants down, akramakum Allah, and he urinated in the masjid in front of everybody. Because that's the mentality of the Bedouin. Man bada jaffa, that's what the hadith said. Man bada jaffa, anyone who lives with, like, way out in the frontiers. In the frontiers of Pakistan, Afghanistan, Somalia, in Algeria, in Libya, yes, in Algeria and Libya, in whatever. If someone lives far, far out in the desert, they tend to be coarse, rough, tough. That's just the nature of the place because you have to survive. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, we used to love it when one of them would come. Because when they came, they had no time. They just asked their questions and they get out. Whereas the companions, they used to be careful how they were. They had more edep. Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu anhu, he was from those ulama. Mu'adh ibn Jabal was from those ulama. So the Prophet sent them out to educate the people. He didn't send the ignorant person to educate the people. That's the point. He said to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, before he sent them to Yemen, إِنَّكَ تَقْدُمْ عَلَى قَوْمٍ مِّنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ فَجْعَلْ أَوَّلَ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ أَنْ يُوَاحِدُ اللَّهِ. You're about to go to a group of people from Ahlul Kitab, ya Mu'adh ibn Jabal. So when you give them da'wah Allah, make the first thing you call them to is La ilaha illallah. That's what the da'wah is to. The one who's going to give da'wah, he has to have knowledge. The one who has to be who's giving da'wah, he has to know the people he's giving da'wah to. He's going to have a problem. He doesn't know those people. So as a result of not knowing them, he's going to make mistakes. And he has to know what his da'wah has to be on and what it has to be to. Before the Prophet conquered Khaybar, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sitting in front of him tomorrow because Allah allowed him knowledge of aspects of the ilm al-ghayb, not all of the ilm al-ghayb. He allowed him knowledge of some of the ilm al-ghayb. Just as he would allow someone here a little bit of knowledge of the ilm al-ghayb and the mubashirat when he sees in a dream something. Allah will allow him to see an aspect. It doesn't mean you know all of the ilm al-ghayb. And yes, the Prophet knew more of it than anybody else, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but he didn't know all of the ilm al-ghayb. He said to his companions, tomorrow I'm going to give the flag to a man from amongst you. He loves Allah and His Messenger, and Allah and His Messenger loves that man. Tomorrow, Umar radiallahu anhu said, I was so hoping that it was going to be me. The next day came, they gathered. Umar said, I got on my knees. I was sitting like he's sitting. He said, but then I got on my knees and I made myself tall, hoping that the Prophet would call me, showing the hirs that the companions used to have for being that one, for getting those virtues. The Nabi said, where is Ali ibn Abi Talib? They say, Ya Rasulullah, something is bothering him in his eyes. He's not here, he's sick. And he said, go and get him. They went and got him, he came. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spit in his eyes. How did he spit? You know when you do ruqya and you spit on yourself before going to sleep, or if you're praying and you get wiswas from that shaitan that is called khanzib. The Prophet said, turn to your left and spit. The spit is not, it's not that. It's just like this. That's all. Easy, relax, easy, no shidda. He spit in his eyes like that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because on his lisan is the kalam of Allah, and within his body are mu'jizat. When he spit in his eyes, Ali was able to see and the thing went away. And we believe in that. We have to believe that Ali is a special person. Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said he was special, radiallahu anhu. And we have to believe in the tabarruk. We believe in the tabarruk. When he used to make wudu, when the water would fall off of him, the companions used to be tough with each other trying to get that water. He would go to sleep and he would sweat. The lady who was in his house, or the lady whose house he was in, would take that sweat off of him and save it and give it to her children for perfume for Friday. He would get his hair cut, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he himself would pass his hair out and distribute it amongst his companions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His daughter died. He took off some of his clothing, turban, something from his clothes. He said, bury her in this. So we believe in a tabarruk. But what kind of tabarruk? As it relates to human beings, we make a tabarruk only with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I stand here and tell you, it's not permissible for you to make tabarruk with any other human being. The sheikh came and he drank some water that was on the table, and we have so much ghulu. He puts the water down, and there's a person who's sitting there. He doesn't hear any of the kalam for the whole dars. He's just looking out that water, waiting until the class is over. He's going to take that water home, and he's going to save that water. That's not our religion. None of the companions did that with Abu Bakr after the Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, with Umar, with Ali, with Uthman. None of them. We can make a tabarruk as well with the Kaaba, no problem. You can touch the black stone, kiss the black stone. You can make a tabarruk with water of Zamzam, no problem. So anyway, he spit in his eyes, he became well. Prophet gave him the flak. He said, I want you to go, and don't look to the left, and don't look to the right, and don't look behind until you get there. Ali left, and the people left with him. As he was driving away or riding away, he stopped his riding beast, his horse, he stopped. Without looking to the right, without looking to the left, without turning around, he said, Ya Rasulullah, what should I call them to? He told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hatta yaqulu la ilaha illallah, or hatta yashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa anna muhammadan abduhu wa rasuluhu. Go to that place and call them to la ilaha illallah. Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Some people, they understand that fighting in Islam is just being as crazy as you possibly can be. Being a butcher, spreading as much blood and carnage as possible. La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah has nothing to do with the equation. Burning people alive has nothing to do with the equation of La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah. La ilaha illallah, only Allah can punish people with fire. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prohibited us from burning people with fire. So that's the understanding of dawah to many people. So the dawah is to Allah. So he showed us. Dawah is wajib. And he also showed us and told us, what do we call to? What do we call to? When we start giving dawah, we don't call the people to al-khilafah. The khilafah is important by the Lord of the Kaaba. But you know what, Ikhwani? Each one of you is an imam and a sultan. There's a hadith that says, no one shall lead another man in salah in his sultan. Another hadith said, when you go into someone's house, don't sit in his chair. There's a chair, a table that's long, and you see one chair at the head of the table. And then there are three chairs. When you come in, and the owner of the house, he says, come on in, tfaddal. And we all come in, seven of us, or five of us. We're going to sit in the three chairs on the side. No one's going to go to the chair at the head, because that's his sultan. So everyone is an imam and a sultan in his own house. Everyone has a hukuma in his own right. If everybody here establish the khilafah in his house, Allah will establish the khilafah in the earth. But we don't want to establish the khilafah in our own homes, but we want it established in the earth. So the khilafah is important, it's important. But that's not what the Prophet called the people to. He didn't call the people to siyasa like that. He didn't call the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to many of the things that the people, they are important, they're from Islam, but they're secondary. They come down the line. Next issue, ikhwani, is after knowing what should we be calling to, The question now is, how should we call? How do we make da'wah? How do we give da'wah? Again, the Quran and the Sunnah makes it clear that giving da'wah to Allah Azza wa Jalla, it has a way of doing it. And at the top of the list has to be with knowledge. As that ayah said, قُلْ هَذِي سَبِيلِ أَدُوَ اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِ. I call to Allah with knowledge, me and those who follow me. If a person doesn't have knowledge, he's going to make more problems than he is benefit. And you know, in our religion, you don't necessarily have to memorize all of the Quran or a lot of hadith to be considered knowledgeable. You know that book? There's a book in Islam called the 40 Hadith of Al-Imam al-Nawawi. I think everybody heard of that book. If you get that book, you memorize or you read those ahadith, and you understand those ahadith, you're going to get a good concept of what this religion is. Those hadith, Al-Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, I'm going to do what the scholars did before me. Scholars before Al-Imam al-Nawawi, they would make a book and they would call it the 40 hadith in the virtues of jihad. Another one, 40 hadith in al-nikah. Another one, 40 hadith in la ilaha illallah. 40 hadith in this, 40 hadith in that. Al-Imam al-Nawawi said, I'm going to do 40 hadith in the Jawami' al-Kalim. The Jawami' al-Kalim. The Nabi was given, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 5 things he said that no other prophet was given. And one of those things is the Jawami' al-Kalim. That was the ability to say something that had a few words, but it had far-reaching implications. If a person understood that hadith, those books, that book, and those, it'll be okay, wallahi. I don't say that's all he has to stop for, but he'll have a lot of knowledge. The knowledgeable one from our religion is the one, he just doesn't know halal and haram, but he knows halal and haram, and he knows the dalil, he knows why. Even more important, he's the one who he's confronted. He wants to choose one of these two things, and both of them are good. And this is khayr, and this is khayr. The knowledgeable one is the one who knows how to choose which one is the afdal al-khayrain. Which one is the better of the two? Which one has the most khayr in it? That's the knowledgeable one. On the other side, he has to choose, and this is evil and this is evil. He has to choose one, he has to fall into it in his life. Like divorce or stay with her. Divorce is a problem, staying with her is a problem. The one who has knowledge, he's the one who knows how to choose the lesser of the two evils. The lesser of the two evils. If you were to ask the average person, many people from our ummah, like there's a wadi. You know, a wadi is like where the water used to go, and now there's no more water. It's dried up. But it made like a valley in the earth. So on this side is elevated, and over there is elevated, and that's where you have to walk through, the wadi. You have to walk through. You tell someone, okay, listen. I'm going to tell you. You have to cross from here all the way over there, 100 yards, at nighttime. In the wadi, there are cactuses, glass, scorpions, snakes, sharp rocks, all kinds of problems. Look, I'm going to give you this light, a spotlight, the one like for the airplanes that goes in. I'm going to give you the spotlight. You can see every minute particle in the way. You can avoid everything. But the spotlight, I can't guarantee it's going to stay on for the whole duration of your trip. It can cut out any moment. Or I'm going to give you this candle. This candle. It'll stay lit from here to there, but you only can see a few inches or feet in front of you. But it's going to stay lit from here to there. Because of the type of society we live in, drama. We like drama. People believe anything. It's easy to fool people today. Any WhatsApp thing, people believe it. Anything the news say, people believe it. All the news people have to do is say this happened, and the Muslims say, then we believe it. That's how the society is. Many people will say, give me the spotlight. Give me the big light. But the Muslim, he says, no. Fiqh and fahm, it tells me I want to definitely arrive, so give me the candle. That's the knowledgeable one in our religion. He has the ability to do that. When you see these groups in the world who are doing the things that they're doing, when you see people doing the things that they're doing, and it's confusion, fold up, corruption, then know for surety, that's not what the Prophet brought. The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a man who had wisdom. And when he came, you see in the decisions that he made, he was Hakim, Aqil, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So a da'wah of Allah has to be done with knowledge. Has to be done with knowledge. Number two, a da'wah in Allah, it has to have some ease to it and gentleness. Where is the ease and the gentleness in what we see in the Muslim world today? What we see in Iraq and Syria, Somalia. Where is the ease and the gentleness? How we are dealing with situations. We see wahshia with the Muslims, wallahi. Even amongst ourselves, don't look all the way in Iraq, just amongst ourselves. It's rough, it's tough. Allah described Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his companions. And keep in mind that his companions were from the awliya of Allah. They were not like us. They were from the awliya of Allah. Just as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is Mustafa, Allah chose him. His companions are Mustafun, Mukhtarun. Allah chose them divinely. He said about him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and about them, radiyallahu anhum ajma'in, فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلُوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَمْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. It was a rahmah, ya Muhammad, from Allah, that you were easy with these people, with your companions. If you were rough and tough with them, they would have run away from you. They would have dispersed. The natural response to someone who's rough and tough is that he's going to leave you. Now I say, and I'm a father, and I'm responsible for children. I say to you fathers, our children are growing up in this society. They get older and older. When they become teenagers, I guarantee you, Allahu A'lam, if we are rough and tough with those kids, we're going to run them away. You brought them here. You put them in this position where they're growing up here. So you have to meet the challenge. You can't be rough and tough. When he sent those people to Yemen, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, Abu Dujana, he sent them to Yemen. He said to them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Bashiru wa la tunafiru, Yassiru wa la ta'assiru. When you go to those people, give them glad tidings. Tell them you're going to go to Jannah. Man qala la ilaha illallah naf'atu yawma min dahrihi. Give them the glad news. Tell them about all of the abwab of al-Jannah and all of the opportunities that they have to get to Jannah. Give them glad news and don't run them away. Don't run them away. When I became a Muslim, Ikhwani, I became a Muslim and the 10th of Muharram was right around the time I became a Muslim. I became a Muslim before the 10th of Muharram. When the 10th of Muharram came, my mother was watching CNN. This was in 1986. And she saw some footage in Iran when people were beating themselves. They had swords chopping themselves in the head. Now, I'm not trying to make you laugh. I'm telling you the incident. I'm sharing an incident with you. One of the men had his son showing him to be brave, shuja. He had a sharp knife hitting his son in the head. Teaching his son, giving him tarbiyah on this stuff. Blood was everywhere. All over the place, blood. At the masjid. It was out in the front of the masjid, marble on the floor, white, you know, like in Mecca, the way the floor is. When my mother saw that, she was horrified. She thought that was the religion I accepted. It's already enough that I left the religion that she was born and raised on. So when I became a Muslim, she said, like Quraysh said, why do you leave the religion of your forefathers? So that was disturbing. Also, what was disturbing, the ilah that I worship, his name is Allah. Allah. So she's thinking it's another God, someone else. Disturbing things. Then she saw that on the news and she was horrified. She called me up. She said, hey, turn on CNN. I turned on the CNN and I saw it. She said, is that your religion? I said, no, man, that's not my religion. Those are people who are doing something just like you people change your religion. You people change the people who were really following Isa ibn Maryam, not you, but the people who were following him, they changed his religion. And the people who were following Musa changed his religion. These people change what our religion is about. That's not my religion. Anyone who sees that and he has some aql, he says, I don't want that religion. All this blood and all of this. Who wants something like that? What we see going on in Iraq and Syria, these non-Muslims say, well, what is that? What is this behavior? That's tanfir. And also tanfir is being rough and tough. The little man, the little boy from the companions, he was suffering from what, or he was dealing with what our Shabab deal with. You know, it's shahwa. It's something natural. He came in front of all of the people, and he was young. He said, Ya Rasulullah, idhin li fi zina. Give me permission to make zina. When the people heard that question, the people looked at him and they were about to jump on that boy. That's a'ib. Ah, how can you say that? That's a fadiha. What are you talking about? Why didn't you take him on the side? You saying that? Just imagine his father, his uncles, and the people who know him. Ya Rasulullah, give me permission. I want to make zina. They said, what's wrong with you? Then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did this to the people. Take it easy, relax. He said, come. You want the people to do that with your mother? He said, A'udhu billah. You want the people to do that with your sister? No. With your khala? No. With your amma? No. He said, well, the people don't want that to happen to their mothers, your sister. He took the boy and he hugged them and he made dua. The boy said, that thing went away from me. That's the rahmah that the Nabi had with people. Now that doesn't mean that he was always like that with everybody. He made jihad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he conquered Mecca and he had fatah Mecca, he told his companions, everybody is free. Everyone from Mecca, from the Quraysh, Kuffar, even if they didn't believe, they're free. We let them go. They're the tulaqa, we let them go. But if you catch Fulan and Fulan and Fulan and Fulan, if you catch these four men, even if they're holding on to the curtain of the Kaaba, seeking protection, I'm at the Kaaba. This is the Hurm of Mecca. Don't touch me. He said, even if you find four of these people hanging on to the curtain of the Kaaba, kill them. Why? Because they were from the Shu'ara. They were from the poets of the Arabs who used to say poetry about the mahasin of the Prophet's wives. They didn't know anything about his wives, but in order to make problems and make adha for him, وَمِنْهُمُ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ النَّبِي, they used to make problems. When they did that, he was a person who had ghira, he had jealousy. He had jealousy. So he wasn't always, everything is rahmah. One of his companions had on a gold ring. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took the ring off, and he threw it on the ground and he said, there will be no khalaq for the person who wears this in the hereafter. You get no portion of the hereafter. And he left and the gold ring was on the floor. The people witnessed it. They said, pick up the ring, sell it, get money from it. He said, I will never pick up something that the Prophet threw down. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why did he do it with that man? Because that man, he can handle having the ring taken off and thrown down. Abu Bakr Umar, his companions who were with him all the time, they can handle that. But generally speaking, he was easy. He was gentle. So a da'wah ila Allah, ikhwani, he has to be with ease. But again, I repeat, not all the time. And that's why the ayat of the Quran has said, udu'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal mu'idati al hasana wajadilhum bilati hi ahsan. Give dawah to Allah with hikmah. Hikmah, and I want you guys to remember this, inshallah, it's a really important aspect of our religion. Hikmah is in every language. It's in the Urdu language, it's in Somali language. Every revert knows the word hikmah. They translate it as being wisdom. And it is wisdom, but the real meaning of hikmah is wadru shay fi mahallihi munasib. Putting things in the proper place. That's hikmah. The one who has the ability to put things in the proper place. He knows when to talk, what to say, when to be quiet. He knows when to be strong, when to be soft. He knows when to turn the other way. He knows when to go forward. Allah is Al-Hakim. He's El Hakim because he put everything in the proper place. He knew who to give children to, who to give boys to, who to give girls to. His religion, halal and haram, he knew what he was doing. So the Muslim should never come. The woman, she can never come and say, why can't I have two husbands, or three husbands, or four husbands? Because Allah is Hakim, he didn't make it like that. He didn't make it like that. The person comes and say, why is it? The Muslim lady comes and say, why is it that a man gives two portions to the woman's one portion when it comes to and miraf? Because Allah is Hakim. And you and me, you don't have children, don't say why, because Allah is Hakim. You don't have a lot of money, Allah gave some of these people money that they don't have the word how much is not in their vocabulary, it's not in their vocabulary. Whatever they want, they can purchase. Man has $30 billion, he goes and he buys an island for himself, only for him and his family. But if you don't get that, you can't say why, and you're struggling every month. 200 pounds you have saved up. You didn't even get your rent money yet. The rent money, you didn't get it yet. You struggle every month. And you have to pray and get up for Fajr, and you have to fast Ramadan, you have to go to Hajj, and you say why? Because Allah is Al-Hakim. You know what he was doing. So all you have to do is be patient and believe in what he revealed. You're going to be okay. So again, a da'wah should be easy and it should be soft. But there are places and there are times when you have to be rough, you have to be tough. If he gave the khutbah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala sawtuhu, wa shtadda ghadabuhu, wa ahmarrat aynahu ka'annahu mundhiru jaysh. If he gave the khutbah, his voice would go loud. His anger would become passionate and speak angrily. His eyes would become red, as if he was warning the people of an army. Sometimes you go to some khutbah and the imam or the khatib who's giving the khutbah, he's up there and he's saying, and we all gonna go to Jannah and it's going to be okay. And people in there and they're sleeping. And then if a person practiced this sunnah, some people are offended and they come and they say, why are you so mad? Why are you so angry? Now obviously you shouldn't go overboard, but I'm just trying to show the point that hikmah, it means there are certain places and certain times for different behaviors. So a da'wah Allah, ikhwani, has to be gentle, it has to be easy. As for the virtues of da'wah, there are many. Like what he told Ali, radiyallahu anhu, liyan yahdi Allahu bika rajulin wahida. If Allah guided one person by you, it's better for you than the red camel. And that person doesn't have to be someone who's ajnabi, minka or anka, someone who's a foreigner, to guide your child, to guide your mother, to guide your brother, to guide your sister. If one person was guided because of you, then this is a good thing. He told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ad-daru ala khayrin kafa'ilihi. Anyone who guides someone to good will get the reward. Well, bin munasaba, today, I read something on my Facebook page that I really don't have much to do with. There are people who are running that Facebook page. But they send me when there's a problem here and there, and then I have to get involved. But someone wrote me a private letter, and he said to me, and I'm sharing this with you from the bab of وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ, from that bab. When Allah gives you a ni'mah, you talk about it. And that's part of the shukr of the ni'mah. The person wrote to me a letter, a short note, and he said, I want to thank you because you helped me to get away from the extremism that I was upon, making takfir of Muslims, just making takfir. We have takfir in our religion when we excommunicate people. We have that in our religion, but it requires knowledge. It's not just like that. So the person thanked me. Now, anytime you have something to do with guiding someone the right way or helping them to do something that he didn't know, you get that reward. You see a person in this masjid, for an example, he's praying and he's not praying towards a sutra. He's praying and there's no sutra in front of him. And you know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded us to pray with a sutra. He prohibited us from praying without a sutra. Whenever he was in the house, when he was in the masjid, whenever he was in the middle of the desert, he would take his spear and put it in the ground. He would make his camel sit down, and then he would pray towards it as a sutra to prevent anyone from walking in front of him. You know about that issue. So you came and you said to the person, hey, the Nabi says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا صَلَّ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلَا يُصَلِّيَنَّ إِلَّا إِلَى sutra. If one of you pray, don't pray except towards a sutra. You share that with him. He takes that hadith from you. From that moment on, when he starts to practice that hadith, that sunnah, to the rest of his life, you get that reward. And that's just an example. Whatever you know, you share that with an individual, that's it. The person comes into the masjid and he sits down. He doesn't know the ruling that the Prophet told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا دَخَلَ أَحَدُكُمْ الْمَسْجِدْ فَلَا يَجْلِسْ حَتَّى يُصَلِّي رَكَعْتَيْنِ. If any of you come into the masjid, don't sit down until you pray to rak'ah. Once you tell him that, he practices it and you get the reward. That's from the virtues of the da'wah. Someone sneezes. He says, achoo. He didn't know that you should say alhamdulillah after saying achoo. He didn't know. Achoo. You have to say alhamdulillah. And then the person who said that to him, he says, who said to him, he says, yarhamakullah. He says, yahdikumullah, yuslu barakum. That's a da'wah ilallah. And that's the reward of a da'wah ilallah. Don't be a person who's afraid to get rewards from people. Lastly, ikhwani, the benefits of da'wah. Now, this benefits of da'wah, there are many, many benefits. And I want to end on this. Inshallah. There are many benefits of giving da'wah Allah. Like a da'wah clearly is ibadah from the ibadat of al-Islam. So from the time that a person is baligh, he has his intellect, he knows what he's doing, he has to give da'wah, but he has to give da'wah with knowledge. Until the time he dies, he has to give da'wah. Like the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. الْيَقِينَ, away from how some funny people translate it. No, not the yaqeen of Sufism. Worship Allah until death comes to you. Yaqeen. The Nabi was dying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was dying. He was dying. He wrapped his head up with a bandage very tightly because he had a serious migraine. They say, Ya Rasulullah, you're in a lot of pain. Why, you know, Allah is putting you, have all this pain. He said, I get double the pain of any one of you. And that's because he's going to be in the Maqam al-Mahmud. No Bani Adam is going to go to Jannah the way we are right now. You have to get cleaned up. Even the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He told the people, none of your actions will be put you in Jannah. You can't do enough to go to Jannah because of your actions. Nobody. They said, even you, Ya Rasulullah? He said, even me. But Allah submersed me in His rahmah, so I'm going to go to Jannah. Your actions, when people go to Jannah, Salah, Zakat, Hajj, Umrah, your actions, when you go to Jannah, they'll determine what level you're on. But you can't get into Jannah because of your actions. From the sunnah of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if a person comes out of the hammam, akramakumullah, comes out of the toilet, and if one of you yawns like this, the Nabi said, if you yawn, don't go like this. And definitely don't go, he said, the shaitan goes in your mouth. So if the Muslim yawns, the Nabi told you to do this. Try to hold it. If you can't, then cover up your mouth with the right hand. So anyway, ikhwani, anyway, when we come out of the hammam, the sunnah is to say, ghufranaka, Allah forgive me. Allah forgive me. What did he do that he has to say, Allah forgive me? What did he do? He didn't do anything necessarily. It's just that Allah forgive me because the ability that you just gave me to relieve myself, I can't thank you just for that. The ni'mah of being able to relieve yourself, I can't thank you for that. Not to mention the ni'mah of my eyesight, my earsight, my children, my wealth, my stability. Any of us can find ourselves right now in Palestine, right now. Any of us can find ourselves right now in Iraq, in Syria.
But we in a place, we have stability, we have good health, we have so many issues. So he used to come out of the toilet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used to say, ghufranaka, because of the ni'mah. So your actions can get you into the Jannah. And this is really important concerning the names and attributes of Allah. Allah is Al-Basit. Allahu yabsitu ar-rizqa liman yasha' wa yaqdir. Al-Basit, he gives people. Allah is ar-Razzaq. Inna Allah huwa ar-Razzaq dhul quwwati al-mateen. He gives everybody, everything in creation. Allah Azza Jal is Al-Kareem. And he is Al-Jawad. From his names, actually. Hadith, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَوَّادٌ وَيُحِبُّ الْجُودِ. Allah is generous and he loves generosity. And he's kareem, which means generous. You ask an Arab sitting here, what is the difference between al-kareem and jawad? Because they're not synonyms. They're not meaning the same thing. It's like you ask the Muslim, The basmala, we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Everybody knows that. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Both of those names come from Rahmah, Rahmah. What's the difference between ar-Rahman ar-Rahim? Many people don't know. And that's what the Prophet said about what's going to happen in this religion, to this community, wallahi, we're living in that time. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yadrusu al-Islamu kama yadrusu wa-shuhu hatta la yudra ma-salat ولا الزكاة ولا الصوم ولا الحج أو النسك ويرفع كتاب الله تعالى في ليلة واحدة حتى لا يبقى في الأرض منه آية. The time is going to come on these Muslims where Islam is going to fade away. The way the embroidery of your thobe fades away. You get a new thobe, it has print in it, it's very dark, it's brand new. But when you wash it and you iron it, you wear it, you wash it, you iron, you wear it, you wash it, it starts to fade away. He said Islam is going to fade away like that. Until the point where people won't know what is salat, they won't know what is zakat, they won't know what is sawm, they won't know what is hajj. And the Quran will be raised up in one night to the point where no one in the earth from the Muslims will know one ayat of the Quran. Like Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is an ayat of every surah of the Quran. Except Surah At-Tawbah. You ask the average person, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, what is Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim? What's the We don't know. It's the condition of our ummah. But the shahid, the point I want to make about the Jannah and so forth, so on. Al-Jawad, Ikhwani, Al-Jawad, he's the person who gives you without you asking. Allah gives you things and you didn't ask for them. Al-Kareem, he's the one who gives you after you ask him. That's the difference between those two names. Allah's Al-Jawad, he gave us many things that we didn't ask for. Al-Jawad, person gives you, someone Allah gives you, and you didn't ask for it. He gave you intelligence. He made you extraordinarily intelligent. He gave you something. Al-Kareem, you asked for it and he gave it. وَآتَاكُم مِّن كُلِّ مَا سَلْتُمُوهُ. He gave you everything that you asked for. He gave you from everything. So we know that distinction because of the hadith of the Nabi when he described Allah. He says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inna allaha hayy kareem yastahi idha rafa'a al-abdu yadayhi fayurudduha sifrun kha'ibatayn. Allah is alive. And Allah is shy. Or Allah is kareem. He is shy if his slave makes dua and he puts his hands up and asks Allah for something. He's kareem. He asks him, if he puts his hand up, Allah doesn't want to not give him his thing. So the point here concerning that issue of the Jannah, people only going to go to Jannah because of the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah put us all in the Jannah to Firdaus without any adab and any hisab. The benefits of da'wah. I just want to mention how I was saying that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught people until the very last moment that he died. He was on the lap of our mother Aisha and she came, and her brother came in, Abdul Rahman, and he had the miswak. The Prophet couldn't even say, can I use that? He was looking at it in the way that she can tell that he wanted it. So she said, let him have it. Abdul Rahman gave it to his sister. She bit the thing off, cleaned it up for him, and gave it to him. And he used the miswak, educating the people of the virtues of the miswak in the last moments of his life, teaching people, giving dawah, last moments, in tough situation. He was in that situation as Ali ibn Abi Talib. Ali ibn Abi Talib said to his students, do you people want to know what were the last words of Rasulullah? Do you know what the last words that came out of his mouth were? They said, Allahu a'lam, we don't know. He said, the Prophet was with us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we could see he was struggling to breathe. He was struggling. It looked like he was going to die. So he lost consciousness, and we were all nervous. And then he opened up his eyes. And then he said to the people, As-salat, as-salat, wa ma malakat aymanukum. Take care of the prayer, take care of the prayer. And take care of your right-hand possessions, your slaves, your children, people you're responsible for. Ali said, and then he lost consciousness, and we became nervous. After some time, he opened up his eyes, and we became happy. And then he said again, As-salat, as-salat, wa ma malakat aymanukum. And then he lost consciousness. Then the third time he woke up, As-salat, as-salat, wa ma malakat aymanukum. And then he died, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the last words that came out of his mouth were telling the people to do the most important thing that Allah made wajib upon you after the Tawheed of Allah. He taught until the yaqeen came to him. That's da'wah Allah. But the last benefit, the very last one, ikhwani, about the benefit of da'wah. If this ummah were to give da'wah, we would get tamkeen in the earth. We would get established in the earth. Not like we see the Muslims right now. If we were to give da'wah in Allah, we will get the assistance and the help of Allah. He will give us a different condition than we have right now. And there are many ayat that prove that. Not one, not two, not three, four, five, 10 ayat that prove that. 10. From them is the statement of Allah Ta'ala, إِن تَنْصُرُ اللَّهِ يَنْصُرْكُمْ وَيُثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامُكُمْ. If you people help Allah, Allah help you, and He'll establish your feet firmly. How do we help Allah? Spreading His religion. And He doesn't need us. But when the Prophet came, he used to say to the people, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will help me to spread the risala of my Lord? He could have did it by himself, bi'idhnillah. Yawm al-Qiyamah, a Prophet will come, he'll have from 3 to 9 people who believed with him. Another Prophet will come, he'll have 2 people who believed with him. Another Prophet will come, he'll have 1 person who believed in him. Another Prophet will come, nobody believed in him. He gave da'wah all by himself, no one believed in him. So the point is, helping Allah's religion, helping Allah, assisting Allah, and He doesn't need you, from His names and attributes is, He is Al-Ghani. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدْ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدْ الصَّمَدْ is the one who doesn't need anybody, self-sufficient. But He gives us a chance. You help Him, He'll help you, and He'll establish your feet. Are our feet established firmly in the land today? كَلَّا وَاللَّهِ. Instead of our feet being established firmly in the land, our necks are on the ground, and they have their feet on our necks. Allah said in the Quran, many ayah, الَّذِينَ, the Imam read one of those ayahs today from Surah Ali Imran. الَّذِينَ يُبَلِّغُونَ رِسَالَاتِ اللَّهِ وَيَخْشَوْنَهُ وَلَا يَخْشَوْنَ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا اللَّهِ وَكَفَى بِاللَّهِ حَسِيبًا. Those people who spread the risalah, the risalat of Allah, they spread His message, and they're not afraid of anybody but Allah. If you're afraid of people other than Allah, you'll be afraid to give da'wah. You'll be afraid to make an amr ma'ruf. You'll be afraid to tell the people, this is what our religion is saying. Those people who spread the message of Allah, and they are only afraid of Allah, no one else. Allah is enough for them. He's the hasib, and He is enough. Hasib here means nasir, the helper. In many ayat, He said to Musa and Harun, Bi ayatina antuma wa min ittabakuma al-ghalibun. Ya Musa, you and your brother, because of our ayat that you're teaching, you're spreading, you're talking about, because of our ayat, you two and those who are following you, you'll be the gharibun. You'll be the victorious ones. There are many ayat like that. Many. Surah al-Jinn. There are ayat all over the Quran. So the point is, ikhwani, a da'wah Allah has its virtues and it is important. It's our responsibility to equip ourselves. I do not encourage anyone to give da'wah that doesn't know what he's doing. We have a lot of keyboard warriors right now, young people on the internet, who are arguing and giving debates with different Muslims, atheists, and this and that. Da'wah is not for everybody. That are beyond your level. Da'wah is not in any and every way. In Denmark, one of the countries where I go to, some Jewish people, they complained of anti-Semitism. They complained of anti-Semitism. So the Muslims wanted to show their solidarity. So what did the Muslims do? Some of the young Muslims, they came together and they made a thing where they surrounded the synagogue. Two men, a woman, a man. And they went around, and this is Dawud Allah. When those three young Muslims in America were shot dead, and the world was quiet about it until social media caused them to pay attention to it, some of the Muslims wanted to show, we're not happy with that. What do? We light the candle and we have a vigil with candles. Is that Dawud Allah? We want to show that we're happy Muslims, so we make the happy video and we're dancing in the street and we're doing all kind of stuff. Is that Dawud Allah? This is the Islam that is presenting itself these days. Dawud, that's gharib, that's ajib. I want to put on a play for the youngsters or something. So in the play, I'm going to do a play. You're going to play Musa. You're going to play Isa. You're going to play Abu Bakr. You're going to play Abu Huraira. And this one's going to play Shaitan. And that's Dawud Allah. And then the other people say, relax, don't be shadeed. Relax, take it easy. That's the Islam that's coming now. And there are just so many examples of that. The Muslim man, he wants to do a thing. He puts a blindfold on. He goes to the busy street here in Kingston. He makes a sign. He says, I'm a Muslim, trust me. And he stands like this. And then some lady comes with tight clothes, tighter, and she comes and she hugs him like that. And is that Dawud Allah? This is what's happening to our ummah, ikhwani. The religion is changing. So as the ayah said, وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنكَرِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. There has to be a group of people who are going to stand forward, try to do the right thing. وَلَا تَزَالُ طَائِفَةٌ مِنْ أُمَّةِ عَلَى الْحَقِّ مَنْصُورًا. Will always be a group of people, always in this ummah, they'll be trying their responsibility. The brothers and the sisters, the elders and the youngsters, the Arabs and the non-Arabs. As for these many groups that we have, and every group is happy with what it is doing, this is not the way. We have to get with the program, learn our religion, inshallah, and may Allah Ta'ala give us the tawfiq. What we're going to do very quick, we're not going to do a lot of questions, we're going to do 4 questions for the brothers and 2 questions for the sisters. Because the ulama, as Allah said, the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-ulama'u warathatul anbiya. Al-ulama'u warathatul anbiya. لا يورثون دينارا ولا درهم إنما يورثون العلم. When the Prophet died, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Abu Huraira went to the souq and he said, "What are you people doing in the marketplace? The mirath, the inheritance of the Prophet, is being distributed." So the people went to the masjid, and when they got there, they saw the people over in the halaqa, Quran, halaqa, hadith, halaqa, the tariq of the Arabs, halaqa over here. "Where's the money, Abu Huraira?" He says, "There's no money. This is the mirath of the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." So since knowledge is the inheritance of the Nabi, the man gets 2 to the woman is 1. So we do 4 questions for the men, 2 questions for the women, and then we're going to call it a day, inshallah, as we check. So if you brothers have any questions, very quickly, inshallah.
تفضل يا أخي.
جزاك الله خير يا شيخ. In terms of being balanced, in terms of you said that you have to be easy, at the same time you have to be rough and tough. We have a few brothers, يعني, in terms of those who try to call to the Quran and Sunnah and the way of the Salaf. When they do so, they're generally rough and tough, and they say that they, you know, you have to be an individual that makes inkar when inkar needs to be done. So can you advise on exactly when does do brothers need to make inkar, or do we have to make inkar at all? How does it work exactly?
Concerning the question of the brother, we have some people who have a claim that they are the people on the Kitab and the Sunnah, and they want to follow the Kitab and the Sunnah in accordance with the way the Salaf follow the Kitab and the Sunnah. So many times they are described, and you can see them as being overly rough and overly tough. And some of them even make a taqarrub in Allah. They think this is the right way. And they said that whenever something goes wrong and you see it, you have to change it. That question is a long question, but bi-ikhtisar, first thing that we say is the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was an obligation upon him if something was said or done in his presence, he heard it, he saw it, it was wajib for him to deal with it. Because if he didn't deal with it, then that thing was permissible. They call it the sunnah at-taqririya. Something happens and he gives his tacit approval. So he has to say something. If someone says something, do something, he has to deal with it. But he didn't always do that. He was in Mecca, and the people were making tawaf around the Kaaba. He said to Aisha, if your people were not new to Islam, I would have taken the door and put it down the way it was during the time of Ibrahim. But he left it the way it was and the way it is today, because if he would have touched that Kaaba, that door, the new Muslims would have said, that's a sacrilegious act, what are you doing? And it would have made them run from the religion. So he left it, although it should have been up. So that helps us to understand that you need fiqh and fahm. And the principle in the religion is that Allah Ta'ala mentioned, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. فاتقوا الله ما استطعتم. Do things when you have the ability. If you don't have the ability, don't do it. He was in Mecca, for an example, in Mecca, he was in Mecca. They had idols inside of the Kaaba. They drew pictures of Ibrahim making shirk, Ismail, pictures inside of the Kaaba. He didn't change that until he went to Medina and then he came back. And even in Medina, when he went to Medina, he had to share Medina with the Yahud, with Bani Qaynuqa, with Bani Nadir, with Bani Qurayza. He had to share Medina with them. So when you see something, don't think, I have to change everything. Hadith said, من رأى منكم منكرا فليغيره بيدي فإن لم يستطيع فبلساني فإن لم يستطيع فبيدي فبقلبي وذلك أضعف الإيمان. Anyone that shows da'wah is wajib. Anyone who sees a bad thing, change it with your hand. If you can't, change it with your tongue. If you can't, then hate it with your heart. That's the weakest level, that you hate it in your heart. So someone may be in that situation. You have to at least hate in your heart. So some of us, you have to go to the walima, and there's ikhtilat between men and women. There's music, there's this and this and that. You have to go to the janazah in a masjid where they do crazy things. You have to go to that masjid because your relatives are going to get upset. So you have to know when to do, when not to do. That's number one. The other thing is, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, he used to say a word all the time in his books. He wrote this a lot. He said, Ahlul Sunnah arhamul khalq ala al-khalq wa a'lamul nas bil-khaliq. The people of the Sunnah, they have the most rahmah on the creation. And they have the most knowledge about al-khaliq. Why is that? If you're Ahlul Sunnah, then that means you're following the Prophet and his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet was merciful to his companions. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَى رَحْمَةٍ لِلْعَالَمِينَ. He was merciful to them. So if you're really following those companions, you're following the Nabi, then where's the Rahmah? And as I said, Ikhwani, we have empty slogans. Al-Jihad, Al-Jihad, Al-Khilafah, Al-Khilafah, Al-Sunnah, Al-Sunnah, Ahl-Sunnah, Ahl-Sunnah. Hey, as I mentioned, I bite my tongue for no one.
It's my first time in this masjid, and I'm telling you people, when we die and we get raised up Yawm al-Qiyamah, the only Islam Allah is going to accept from people in this room is an Islam that looks like what Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, the rest of those companions were upon. If the companions were not doing that thing, then Allah is not accepting it from you and me, Yawm al-Qiyamah, no matter what you think it was good from these celebrations, from everything. So our advice to those brothers is to calm down and to be easy on the Muslims. Ignorance is prevalent. Even the people giving da'wah are ignorant. So our ummah is in a situation of slumber. Take it easy, like Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Know the condition of the people that you're dealing with. So you have to know when to be rough, when to be tough. But the general rule, ikhwani, is to be soft. And it's like this situation, you know, like the tray, the silver tray that you have water on, silver tray. You can buy very expensive ones, really nice. Then the nice pitcher of water, nice, and a nice cup to match. The man is thirsty, he's really thirsty, and you're bringing him the water, Zamzam. And it's cool, it's nice. And he's in the desert, he was working all day, he's thirsty. And then you bring him the nice water, the nice tray, you give him and you go, in his face. And it falls down his face. And you say, I gave you the water. That's how it is with some of these people's doubt. And then the person has the nerve and the audacity to turn around and say, I'm the sunnah and the way of the salaf of the ummah. I don't sit with people of innovation. I don't sit with, what are you talking about? All of that has its time, its place, and its context. What's your name, Akhi?
Haytham.
Haytham? Akramakullah. Haytham, where are you from?
Oman.
Huh?
Oman.
Oman. Oman. Barakallahu feekum. Fadhi, Akhi.
It's kind of similar, but if there's some brothers in like your locality who have come together to go out and give da'wah, but they have no knowledge whatsoever, and you've established that with them, what is your advice there, what you should do in terms of the brothers who are going to do that, because there's some issues there with their aqidah and everything.
Like we mentioned, the Prophet Sunnah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is to give dawah with knowledge. People with knowledge, the more knowledge you have, and knowledge doesn't necessarily mean age. The more knowledge you have, the more that is expected of you. I became a Muslim, just to make it personal very quickly. I became a Muslim. I was looking for the haqq, and I met different Muslims. I met different jama'at. And I met a group of brothers who were giving da'wah, and I liked being in the masjid and things like that, trying to grow and to develop. But only after 3 days of being there, I was there Friday, Saturday, Sunday, they told me to get up and talk. I've been a Muslim for less than a week. I said, I'm going to talk about what? They said, did it come to you? And then when I got up and I spoke, I said what they didn't like, because I wasn't ready for that. Now, obviously, that's an extreme example. But the people who put me up to do that, they should have known. This is not how da'wah is. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent knowledgeable people to give da'wah. He never sent a Bedouin or an ignorant person, ever. Because the Arabs say, فَاقِدُ شَيْءٍ لَا يُعْتِي. The one who doesn't have something can't give it. إِخْوَانِ give صَدَقَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. I'm broke, I can't give anything. Okay, how are you going to give da'wah? You have no knowledge. You have to give da'wah, you, the jahil, the one who has no knowledge, you have to give da'wah on a more simpler level, simple level. As for getting in front of people and talking about the religion because you're sincere, sincerity is nice, but it is not enough. And for that reason, the companions in the past, they used to be rough and tough with people. They used to call them the storytellers, the qasasin. People, the qasas, they tell stories. They told Ali ibn Abi Talib, there's a man, he's giving talks in the masjid telling stories. He's telling stories about himself and stories about this and that. He said he went astray and he's sending the people astray. He went to the masjid, he found that man, what are you doing? He said, I just want to give da'wah, that's all it is. I just want to teach the people, encourage them. He said, do you know the nasikh and the mansukh of the Quran? He said, no. Do you know what was abrogated and what abrogated it? Do you know? He said, no. He said, you got astray and you putting the people astray. I don't want you talking anymore. The masjid. So Imam al-Suyuti wrote a book about that. The book of the storytellers. Our religion is not about storytelling like that. So my advice is that people who are on that way, that you desist from that. Get knowledge of your religion and give da'wah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that will please Him.
These sisters or brothers, they stand in the streets on the da'wah stores or post YouTube videos and they have not studied with the shuyukh. Is this allowed? When many sisters do this, other people find out who they are, whereas the wives of the Prophet used to try to contain their identity.
That's a good question concerning what we find today, people who set up dawah stores up and down the country and things of this nature. On one hand, this is a cool thing. This is okay to be aggressive and to take the initiative and to give dawah in public. This is an opportunity that Muslims have in this country. This is one of the unique aspects of the UK, that the UK has been very tolerant with people. Unfortunately, this tolerance was taken advantage of by Muslims who are rough and tough, and now we find them passing legislation where they're choking us, where we may not even be able to have halal meat anymore, where our children are going to learn sex education in schools, where they are attacking and looking for our schools to close them down, where they're changing our religion. You can't even say things that are from mainstream statements of Islam. So, taking the initiative and being aggressive and going out in the public square and the streets and so forth, giving da'wah, this is a good thing. Because the Prophet ﷺ had to deal with hostilities. You come out of your house in Mecca, if you turn the corner, that may be the last day you walk on the face of the earth. Now we go and set up a da'wah store. So when we set up the da'wah store, there are rules and regulations that should be followed. You don't necessarily have to have studied under ulama to do that. It's just when you go out there, know your level. Some people know how to talk to people. You will find an individual from the non-Muslim, he's into drugs, drunkards, people have problems, mental problems, they're looking for messages, they're trying. So you may have the ability to talk to that individual, to inspire that individual. That's how many of us became Muslims. Many men and women became Muslims that way. Just know your place and stay in your lane. Don't be out there giving fatwas about this and that. You talk to people's minds. You explain to them what Islam is in an easy way. You don't need ulama to do that. You don't need an ulama. You don't have to have studied under a scholar to be able to do that. As it relates to our women doing that, kalla, mayambabi. That's something that shouldn't happen because it goes against what the Quran and the Sunnah is telling us. Allah Ta'ala commanded in the Quran to the women of our community, وَقَرْنَ فِي بُيُوتِكُنَّ وَلَا تَبَرَّجْنَ تَبَرَّجَ الْجَاهِلِيَةِ الْأُولَى. You women should stay in your homes and don't make this display like the times of a jahiliyyah. The women in time of jahiliyyah, they used to come out, they used to be seductive, they used to walk in a certain way, they used to have perfume, they were out in the public. So the asl for the woman is to stay in her house. She comes out of her house when it is needed. And when she comes out in a way that is acceptable. That's Islamic. As for being in front of the people, giving a lecture, kalla. As for her going out giving da'wah like that, that's not from our religion. That's not from our religion. So this thing is one of the problems that we're facing. It's okay, women have to give da'wah. But she gives da'wah in a way that is restricted and constricted. Why? Because Allah is al-Hakim. Allah said in the Quran, "Laysa dhakru kal untha." The woman is not like the man. The woman is not like the man. And that ayah was revealed for a reason that clearly shows and indicates this. Now is not the time to get into that tafsir. So we don't encourage that and we don't support that. Our women, my daughter, my wife, your sister, we don't agree that they should be outside talking to people and having these problems. I gave the khutbah yesterday in Derby. Stopped to fill up the tank. My wife was in the car. as I was walking, I know these two white guys. I know they said something about Mecca. I know they said something, but when I looked around to give them the Mike Tyson look, when I looked around, they weren't looking at me. They were looking at each other. Okay, so I said, okay, they really don't want anything. So I went inside. I became busy inside and then I came out. I find my wife in the car. She's, alhamdulillah, Abu. You know those two white guys, when they pulled out, they stopped in front of the car and they were looking at me like this. They were looking like trying to intimidate my wife. And she's just minding her business. Now, she happened, the Qadr, she happened to be there at that moment because we stopped for petrol, for gas. What about the lady putting herself in harm's way? La kella. We say, don't give dawah like that to our sisters. No. With that, I want to thank the administration of the masjid and all the brothers who have something, giving this opportunity to come call you brothers to the religion of Al-Islam to remind you of those things which you already know. But I want to say, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I may not see you people again after today. So therefore, I leave you with these parting words. These parting words. The Prophet ﷺ brought us a religion that explains everything. Everything. We're not in need of anything. No additions and no subtractions. وَنَزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ تِبْيَانٍ لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. This religion explained everything. What finger to wear the ring on? You can wear it on this finger, and that's it. Men can't wear the ring finger on those rings. You want to go to the toilet, akramakum Allah, the adab, we know. How to put your shoe on, take your shoe off. How to welcome the child, the janazah. Everything in our religion is known. Everything. He didn't leave one thing. He left us on what? The Mahajjatul Bayda. A religion that is clear. The night is like his day. But the only way we're going to know about that is if we learn. So my parting words of advice to you, we may never meet again, is the only Islam Allah is going to accept for me and you, Yawm Al-Qiyam, when we die, is Islam that those companions were a part of. So we take the Quran and the Sunnah, that's not enough. We take the Quran and the Sunnah, and we take what those companions and how they understood the Quran and the Sunnah. Any aqidah, any ibadah that they didn't do, we don't do it. Hada wa sallallahu wa sallam mubarak ala nabiyyina. Wassalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.